We're going to be talking now about how to recognize the brain sulci and gyri. But initially, I would like to start again with some with 2D slides. And now just to talk about some historical and general aspects, which I think that are interesting in regarding this topic. It's interesting that the trepanation to do a burr hole or a craniotomy or a craniectomy seems to be the oldest systematized operative procedure of mankind, of our history. It was done, you know, very, very early in the Neolithic period, and so it shows that man has a lot of interest and curiosity regarding the brain and trying to study the brain and related the brain to many religious, mythological, and of course, medical, scientific stuff as well. But it didn't pay a lot of attention to the brain surface. That's what I'm trying to show. In the Greek civilization, this gentleman here from Crotum, Alcmaeon, related the brain already with thinking, okay, with thinking. And then Hippocrates already did relate the brain with seizures, as you all know. And Erasistratus, who lived in Alexandria in Egypt, already related the complexity of gyri in men with intelligence. When we go to Roman civilization, it's interesting, there was not many contributions regarding the brain. Galen did study mostly animals and did some contributions, like the cranial nerves, for example, but did not pay any attention to the brain surface. We are here just around Jesus Christ time. And if we go ahead about 15 centuries, we have the great father of anatomy, Andreas Vesalius. And you see that he did a lot of contributions to the anatomy of the nervous system. But you see that regarding the surface, it was very chaotic, was not organized at all. And when we go through the Renaissance, we see all these illustrations of some people that gave a lot of contributions, but again, regarding the surface, it was completely chaotic, not organized at all. You see the big Raymond Vicens, who did describe the white matter and who did describe the projection fibers, started to do fiber dissection in his way, but again, the convolutions of the brain was completely disorganized. You have here Francis de la Beau Silvius, which is the man that gave his name for the description of the so-called Sylvian fissure, the lateral fissure of the brain. But the rest of the brain was completely disorganized. And Silvius did relate, as did Erasistratus many, many centuries ago before him, that the gyri was similar to the convolutions of the small intestines. They used to say that it had an intestinal organization. It's interesting that Silvius did describe gin, G-I-N, you know, for the ones who like a dry martini like I do, was Silvius that invented gin. It's unbelievable. Then we came to already 17th century, Big Thomas Willis in England. He did this very interesting book on brain anatomy that was illustrated by the known architect Christopher Wren, and who was his friend, did the illustrations for this beautiful book. Thomas Willis was particularly interested in the cognitive functions of the brain, but he described the circle of Willis, as you know. But if you go to the convolutions again, not organized at all, completely disorganized. Luigi Rolando did study very much the central sulcus, but only the central sulcus. And Fauville, now we are already in the 19th century, was the first one that did illustrate the convolution with its organization, with its real anatomy, but did not describe it at all. Was only this Louis Pierre Graciolet, who was the mentor and professor of Broca, who describe the organization of the brain. So it's interesting that we are here in the mid 1900s. So this is 160, 170 years ago. Only less than two centuries ago that the organization of the Gyri was described by Louis Gratiolet. I think that maybe it was the last discover, the last description of macroscopic anatomy was the brain convolution. Louis Gratiolet showed that in the so-called frontal region, the anterior region, we have three longitudinal gyri, just like in the temporal region. And the so-called suprasieven area of the brain was divided by two very well positioned vertical oblique gyri. The parietal region has these two big quadrangular lobules, and the occipital region was not very well organized in men. But he did describe this. And regarding the medial aspect of the brain, he described we have a very well-defined inner ring that Broca later on called the limbic lobe, the limbic gyrus. And so in around a less well-defined outside ring that was the continuation of the gyri of the dorsolateral surface of the brain, the supralateral surface of the brain. So this organization is only 150, 160 years ago by Louis Gratiolet, and that's what we're going to be talking about. This is a paper of ours. It was a review, was already mentioned, and we had this privilege of having had our paper as the most accessed in journal neurosurgery. I've been told that until now there was no more accesses than this paper, and this is just a review. This is to show how people is interested in anatomy and how necessary the anatomy is. The last edition of Gray's Anatomy, we already went through all this that I'm going to be talking about. So let's put our glasses and go through this understanding of the sulci and gyri of the brain. Okay, let's see here. Okay, first thing to understand is that while the pia mater is very, very well attached to the whole brain surface, going through all accidents, the arachnoid, it's like an envelope of the whole CNS, of the whole central nervous system. So the sulci that, as I said in the first lecture, they came throughout an infolding of the brain, throughout phylogeny, throughout evolution, in order to increase the brain surface, makes that the sulci are a continuation, are an expansion of the subarachnoid space. So we have to understand the sulci and the fissures. We are the more constant and bigger anatomical constant sulci. We have to understand this as extensions of the subarachnoid space. So nowadays, they are not only the limits, the geographic limits of our brain surface, but also always potential surgical corridors, as I'm going to try to show you tomorrow with some tumor surgeries. This infolding process was very, very effective. We have just to remind you that if we consider the interhemispheric fissure, two-thirds of the brain surface are buried inside sulci and fissures, two-thirds. Also due to this infolding process, of course, the gyri are continuous along their extremities. Always when you have a gyrus connection is because you have the interruption of a sulcus, okay? So just as we have to understand the sulci as extensions of the subarachnoid space, we have to understand each gyrus not as a real structure, but a very well-defined structure, but we have to consider them as regions. Some of the gyri are very constant, but most of them are not. So we have to understand them as regions, not as real, definite anatomical structures. Of course, they are not continuous only along the connections. They are continuous inside the depth of the sulci. And the small gyri that are inside this depth, they are generically called transverse gyri. So we have small transverse gyri inside this infolding process inside the depth of the sulci of sulcus and fissures. Another very interesting feature for us neurosurgeons regarding the sulci of the superolateral surface of the brain and basal surface of the brain is that due to this bending process around the thalamus, and at the same time that this unfolding process took place, the sulci of the superolateral surface of the brain and of the basal surface of the brain are always taking us to the nearest ventricular cavity. You can see that they have this direction always towards the nearest ventricular cavity, which is very useful for us in microneurosurgery, because if we're going along a sulcus, we know that, and we obey its direction, we know that we are going towards the next, the closest ventricular cavity. You see here, we did remove the posterior part of the middle frontal gyrus, and you see that the depth of the superior frontal sulcus and of the inferior frontal sulcus just naturally take us to the ventricular cavity. Now, this is not true for the medial surface, because the sulci of the medial surface, they are dependent in the development of the corpus callosum, and that's why they are parallel to the corpus callosum. The development of the corpus callosum takes together this sulci in the mesial part of the brain. So the corpus callosum is developed from anterior to posterior. So if you have an agenesis of the corpus callosum here, as you have just the most anterior part developed, you have a complete disorganization, a chaotic organization of the gyri, or the sulci and gyri of the inner surface of the brain. So this is very interesting. So let's start recognizing the superolateral surface of the brain, also called convexity, also called the dorsal surface of the brain. And when we look at this, of course, we see very well defined the Sylvian fissure, the lateral fissure of the brain, which is the only fissure that we can very securely recognize in surgery. And of course, it separates the frontal lobe from the temporal lobe. The frontal lobe is organized in three big, very well-defined longitudinal gyrus, superior, middle, and inferior, just like the temporal, superior, middle, and inferior temporal gyri. You have the superior frontal sulcus, which generally is a very continuous sulcus, usually a continuous sulcus. The inferior frontal sulcus is always interrupted, just like in the temporal region. The superior temporal sulcus is interrupted here, but usually is a very well-defined continuous sulcus and very deep. Just like the inferior frontal sulcus, the inferior temporal sulcus is always interrupted. I'm sorry, I lost again my microphone. Hello? Okay. Well, so coming back to the Sylvian fissure, usually you have a specific point, which you call the, it was described as the Sylvian point. We now call the anterior Sylvian point because you have a posterior Sylvian point. This point is pretty much well defined, usually more than in these specimens that you're going to be seeing the next specimens. And from this point, You have a division of the Sylvian fissure in a lateral branch or posterior branch and an anterior part or sphenoidal part. And from the anterior Sylvian point, you always have two branches. One that it's called horizontal branch, and this other one that it's anterior ascending branch, because you have a posterior ascending branch. Horizontal and anterior ascending branch. These branches divide the inferior frontal sulcus in three parts: the orbital part, triangular part, and opercular part. I mentioned in this morning that we have some beautiful U's in the brain surface. And this is the most beautiful U we have, is that it's more constant. If you ask me what I think that it's the most constant feature regarding shape of the brain, I would say the opercular part. The opercular part always have this U-shaped format, always. And since it has this U-shape, it's because you have a sulcus inside here. And this sulcus inside here is always the precentral sulcus. always the precentral sulcus, which is always an interrupted sulcus, because the three longitudinal frontal gyri, they are inserted in the precentral gyrus here. They have this connection. Particularly the middle frontal, which is the bigger one, has a more superficial connection, very, very constant in all specimens, in all people, everybody. But you have this connection here of the inferior frontal sulcus, and you have connections of the superior frontal gyrus, as I'm going to say, I'm sorry, inferior frontal gyrus with the precentral gyrus. You always have these connections. And since you have these connections, the precentral sulcus is always interrupted, particularly at its middle here. So you have a very well-defined pars operculares, opercular part, and as I told you, operculum means curtain. So this opercular part is really covering the insula. The pars triangularis, triangular part, we're going to be seeing that it covers only the anterior short gyrus of the insula, triangular part. And triangular part always have this small branch of the inferior frontal sulcus inside the triangular part. You're always going to see this. And then you have the orbital part that it's always bulging. The anterior sylvan point is more cisternal, is an enlargement of the fissure, because the pars triangularis almost always, is more retracted, it's small. So this is retracted, and this is always bulging. When you see bulging in the surgery, this is the orbital part. Okay, so this anatomy of the inferior frontal gyrus, it's very, very constant. We call frontal operculum, frontal parietal operculum, from the horizontal branch posteriorly, because the orbital part is not covering the insula, so it's not operculum. So the operculum starts here and go back here. We're going to be seeing that the Rolandic operculum, which is the connection between the precentral gyrus and postcentral gyrus, is covering the posterior part of the insula. So horizontal branch, anterior ascending branch. The precentral sulcus is not a branch of the sylvan fissure because you have always have this bottom of the U. And then you have an anterior subcentral and a posterior subcentral. Of course, these are secondary sulci, so they vary. You might have a small one, or you might have two here or three here, one big, other two small, secondary sulci. But you always have anterior and posterior subcentral sulcus, subcentral branches, because they define what we nowadays call the Rolandic operculum, the subcentral gyrus. So this is precentral, this is central sulcus, and this is postcentral sulcus, okay? Precentral gyrus, postcentral gyrus. So this is subcentral gyrus. Used to be called the inferior frontal parietal connection of Broca. Now it's called more subcentral gyrus. By the way, regarding nomenclature, we follow the nomenclature of Ono, Mitiu Ono, that did this nomenclature with Yasser Gilwood. And Ono had the privilege to have worked in both in Yasser Gil's lab and in Trotton's lab, and he has this famous book about sulci of the brain. So subcentral gyrus, precentral, and postcentral. And then we have the parietal region we're going to be seeing next. So if we come to surgery, you always see this enlargement of the fissure. Always see this. So this is the anterior sylvan point. So if you recognize the anterior sylvan point, which is very easy, you have to believe in what you know. Like Professor Yasser Gil says, the more you know, the more you see. Okay? So, and by the way, Yasser Gil emphasizes that here in the anterior sylvan point, you always have this very two small veins here converging, so you can also see these veins. But if you see the anterior sylvan point, you can see the horizontal branch, and you can see the anterior ascending branch. So you can very easily define here the pars triangularis. It's more retracted. And to double check, this part that it's bulging is always the orbital part. So this is orbital part, this is triangular part, hence this is opercular part, hence this is precentral sulcus. You have to believe in what you know. And nowadays, you can go to the radiology and you can study the sulci of and variations of the sulci in your specific patient. And you can plan your surgery regarding which sulci you're going to be using, as we'll try to show tomorrow. That's another specimen, and you see here the anterior sylvan point. A point in anatomy is not a point in geography, in geometry, of course, it's an area. So if this is anterior sylvan point, this is pars triangularis. You see the small branch coming here. The first beautiful U, pars opercularis, so this is precentral sulcus, right? So this is orbital part. A small anterior subcentral, a big posterior subcentral. So this is central sulcus. Now, central sulcus is constant, more than 95%. I mean, it's continuous, more than 95%. But it's not a branch of the sylvan fissure. It's because the subcentral gyrus is inside here. You can bet it's inside here. It goes here, and then it's going to be coming here because you always have this U-shaped format of the operculo rolandic operculum, this area here, inferior frontal parietal connection of Broca. The superior frontal parietal connection of Broca, that nowadays is called the paracentral lobule, is another beautiful U that I already showed you. So what we call the central lobe, Yasagil calls the central lobe, okay, is the precentral gyrus together with the postcentral gyrus and the central sulcus. So it's just like an ellipse that is excavated by the central sulcus. If we go posterior, we have the postcentral sulcus here. Okay? Now, sylvan fissure ends at the posterior ascending branch. You always have this posterior ascending branch. And this descending branch, sometimes you have, sometimes you don't. Okay? Temporal region, superior temporal sulcus, interrupted here, but usually is a continuous sulcus. Inferior temple, always interrupted, just like here. Always interrupted, always. Okay. If we go to the parietal region, we have a very well-defined longitudinal sulcus here that is very deep. It's called intraparietal sulcus. Intraparietal sulcus is pretty much almost always continuous with this inferior part of the postcentral sulcus. Some authors call this intraparietal sulcus, including this part here, like Duvernoy, for example. But what this teaches us is that intraparietal sulcus is pretty much continuous with this part of the postcentral. And postcentral continues up here. Sometimes you have an interruption here, sometimes you don't. Intraparietal sulcus divides the parietal lobe in two big quadrangular lobules. You have one here that it's a quadrangular superior parietal lobule that will be continuous with the precuneus, superior parietal lobule, and inferior parietal lobule. Inferior parietal lobule. Inferior parietal lobule has two gyri, two round gyri. One is the supramarginal, called supramarginal because it goes around the superior margin of the sylvan fissure here. That's why it's supramarginal. And another that it's called angular. Okay? Now, if we come to the occipital region, it's not very well defined in men. But you're always going to see a vertical gyrus here that we call superior occipital gyrus, not well seen in this specimen, in this view. And you have a very pretty much well-defined inferior occipital gyrus that is continuous with inferior temporal. And the middle longitudinal and the middle occipital gyrus that it's more variable. Sometimes you have, sometimes you don't. It's pretty much, when you have it, it's pretty much parallel to the inferior occipital. And the superior occipital is always vertical and continues with the cuneus. We're going to be seeing this later. Now, the superior temporal sulcus always ends in a point which is posterior to the posterior sylvan point, posterior. And here, usually you have a trifurcation. Usually you have a trifurcation. The superior branch separates the supramarginal from the angular, and it's called intermediary sulcus of Jensen. Here, it's also a branch of intraparietal, it's the same sulcus. But sometimes you have one branch coming of the intermediary coming here, and another branch here coming here. And then you have a connection in between the supramarginal and angular, very common. But here, the intermediary is the same sulcus that it's coming from the intraparietal and the superior branch of the superior temporal sulcus. The most horizontal one that it's continuous with this axis here always gets inside the angular gyrus, always gets inside the angular gyrus. And the descending one is more variable, more variable. So you see that, hence, the Sylvan fissure, lateral fissure of the brain, always gets inside the supramarginal. Superior temporal sulcus always ends inside the angular gyrus. So what does it mean? It means that the supramarginal gyrus is always continuous with the superior temporal. You always have this continuation here. Just like the middle temporal is always continuous with the angular. And the inferior temporal is always continuous with the inferior occipital. So this is a very well organized. So you have pars triangularis, you have the pars operculares, you have Rolandic operculum, and then you always have this connection superior to the posterior subcentral, okay? Then you have this connection superior to the anterior subcentral, and then you always have this connection here around the end of the Sylvan fissure. And you have the angular gyrus around the distal end of the superior temporal. And the inferior temporal is continuous with the lingual. So this anatomy is very much well organized, can be different, but it's always like this. And you're going to be seeing later that the inferior temporal is continuous with inferior occipital and then goes around the corner, is continuous with the lingual gyrus. And lingual gyrus will be continuous with parahippocampal gyrus. So this is a big ring, basal ring that you have here. The superior occipital is going to be continuous with the cuneus, and superior parietal lobule is going to be continuous with the precuneus. So this is not chaotic. This is very well organized, okay? Okay, you have, of course, to train this in your MRIs every day, every patient, even normal MRIs you have to see. So when you look at this, what is this here? This space here. Anterior Sylvan point. What is this first beautiful U here? Pardon? Pars operculares. So what sulcus is this? Precentral. Okay, the central lobe always have this quadrangular shape here in sagittal views of MRIs, okay? So this is central sulcus, precentral and postcentral, because I know this is precentral. And here you have supramarginal, continuous with the superior temporal. Okay, this is superior temporal sulcus, this is intermediary sulcus, this is supramarginal, so here is angular. Angular, you have inside the end, the distal part of the superior temporal sulcus that is continuous here. If we had another cut towards us, I bet we would have a small sulcus here, you know, because this is continuous here. I know that it is. And the inferior temporal is continuous with the inferior occipital. So you always have this. So where is exactly the nidus of this AVM? Exactly, where is it? Exactly, this is in the anterior part of the pars operculares. So you know just by recognizing the beautiful U and the anterior ascending, the anterior Sylvan point. Anterior Sylvan point is always at the base of the pars triangularis and just anterior to the pars operculares, very easy. And you see, so this is precentral. So what sulcus is this? Central. So if you have a cavernoma here, you can say I have a cavernoma right in the precentral gyrus, just posterior to the middle frontal gyrus. So you have to be very precise. So, and tomorrow we're going to relate all this with the skull. And so you can put your craniotomy exactly over the region that, and in, of course, you have all this supramarginal with the superior temporal. Here would be the angular. If you have a cavernoma here, you can say it's in the angular gyrus because it's just posterior continuous with the middle temporal. Very well organized. Okay. Middle surface, before I show here, what is this here? Exactly. You see, it's the first, the only beautiful U you're seeing here. So it's paracentral lobule, always this beautiful U. Okay? So we saw a beautiful U, the pars operculares. This is the other beautiful U here. So you see that precentral gyrus, postcentral gyrus, it's vertical, it's oblique. Here is longitudinal. Here is not longitudinal. Here is quadrangular. So you have very well-defined oblique gyri here. So this is central lobe. This is central lobe. So central sulcus is excavated inside this ellipse. And you see how posterior is the paracentral lobule? It's pretty much over the atrium. It's related with the atrium. Okay, superior frontal gyrus, and we're going to be seeing this shortly. Okay, now this slide, I always say that if I had to give a lecture with a single slide, this would be the slide I would choose, you know, because it shows so many things. You're seeing here the superior temporal gyrus. Superior temporal gyrus is not only this. This inner part is also superior temporal gyrus. So superior temporal gyrus has this superior surface, which you call opercular surface. But indeed, operculum, the opercular part, because operculum is what's covering the insula, is just this part here. This part here is not covering the insula, but everything is called opercular surface. But you see that this superior surface is divided by a very well-defined gyrus here. Since this is inside the sylvian fissure, the lateral fissure of the brain, this is a transverse gyrus. Turns out that this is our biggest transverse gyrus that we have in the brain. What gyrus is this? Heschel gyrus. Heschel gyrus always points to the atrium, always. If you stick your finger here, you're always going to reach the atrium very, very easy. Heschel gyrus sometimes is doubles, but most of the time is a single gyrus, divides the superior surface in two planes. One that is inclined, oblique, is the polar plane. Easy to remember because it's next to the pole, okay? And the other one is the temporal plane, which is triangular. Temporal plane, always triangular, with the apex exactly next to the atrium. And it's more flat. It's flat. So it's easy to open the fissure here because this is oblique. Okay, now very difficult to open the fissure here because it's flat, it slips, okay? And the polar planum, which is this, is covering the inferior half of the insula. The superior, you see here the apex of the insula. The superior half of the insula is covered by the frontal parietal operculum. And again, you go back and do anatomical dissections, you see that I left here the pars orbitalis, the orbital part, just to emphasize that the orbital part is not covering the insula. I did remove from pars triangularis posteriorly, okay? So this is to show the superior surface of the temporal lobe. So if you now see in your MRI a lesion in the corona related with oblique Sylvian fissure, you are anterior to the Heschel gyrus. If you see the fissure flat, it's because you are posterior to the Heschel gyrus. You are in the temporal plane. Here you are in the polar plane. So just by looking this, you know, you have to know where you are, just by looking the shape of the fissure in the MRI, okay? Okay, this is another specimen, Sylvian fissure open, okay? What is this here? No. What is this? What is this? What is this? Opercular part. This is the real beautiful you. And you see that you have the precentral sulcus ending here. So this is the? It's more retracted. The anterior sylvian point here is a big lake. Okay, it's an ocean here. It's big, very big. Pars triangularis in this specimen is very much retracted. You see that pars triangularis will be covering only the anterior short insular gyrus here. Pars opercularis is pretty much covering the anterior half of the insula. And pars orbitalis is not covering the lateral aspect of the insula. When you see the Sylvian point, the Sylvian point here is at its depth related with the apex of the insula, related with the apex. So you can see here, we're going to be returning to this. But this slide is to show, to talk again about the opercular superior surface of the temporal lobe. What gyrus is this here? Heschel gyrus. So how do I know? You know that you see that, the gyrus is coming posterior to the insula. I'm sorry for the microphone here. This voice. Just keep looking and seeing where you are there. Okay, let me cut back here. You see that the Heschel gyrus goes posterior to the insula towards the atrium. It's always like this, okay? So if you see through the Sylvan fissure, the opening of the Sylvan fissure, of course go posterior to the insula. Now, Heschel gyrus has two very constant anatomical features, very constant. One is this bulging here. You always see this bulging here in the MRIs. And the other very constant feature is that the postcentral gyrus is always, always sitting over the Heschel gyrus. Always sitting over the Heschel gyrus. So this helps very much when you expose the Sylvan fissure to know where you are. So if you come here, you see the Heschel gyrus, you see the bulging here? That's how the neuroradiologists localize, because they know these tips and they go and they see this bulging here. And just by seeing this, I know that this is the postcentral gyrus, because postcentral gyrus is sitting here. So if I see a cavernoma here, I can say this is a cavernoma is in the postcentral gyrus. So these are tips that help you to build what we are calling here the architecture of the brain. Our beautiful U here, pars operculares, precentral sulcus, is very much easier to recognize the precentral here than the central sulcus. And you see the anterior Sylvan point just superior to the apex of the insula. If you do a hole here, you're going to be damaging what fibers? You're going to be damaging the uncinate fascicle and the IFOF that are running just underneath the apex of the insula. You see the pars orbitalis, not covering the insula at all. Pars triangularis, this branch is coming from the inferior frontal sulcus that it's always interrupted. In the temporal lobe, I forgot to tell you that the middle frontal gyrus usually is shorter than the superior and inferior. And the so-called temporal pole is a meeting, a connection between the superior and the inferior temporal gyri. Always like this, always like this. Okay, so if you open the anterior Sylvan point, you're always going to have the region of the apex of the insula. So, very easy to recognize where you are. Important landmarks. Now, we always think about the insula regarding its lateral surface, just like we think about the corpus callosum in the midline. But the insula has a pretty big anterior surface as well. And this anterior surface is anatomically covered by the posterior orbital gyrus. We're going to be seeing later posterior orbital gyrus. Always have the shape of a Napoleon hat. And if you remove this posterior orbital gyrus anatomically, you're going to be seeing the anterior face, the anterior surface of the insula. The lateral surface of the insula is always surrounded by what we used to call a circular sulcus of the insula. But nowadays, we divided, we don't talk about Europe anymore. I'm going to Europe. I'm going to France. I'm going to Italy. So you have to divide this. Circular sulcus of the insula is a very generic name. So now we divide an anterior limiting sulcus of the insula, a superior limiting sulcus of the insula, and an inferior limiting sulcus of the insula. While the superior and the inferior limiting sulci of the insula are very shallow, they are just deflections towards the opercular surface of the frontal parietal operculum and of the temporal operculum, okay? They are just deflections, very, very shallow. The anterior limiting sulcus of the insula is very deep, because indeed is all the space between the anterior surface of the insula and the posterior orbital gyrus. So if I'm pointing here, I know that this is the posterior orbital gyrus because I know that the posterior orbital gyrus covers the anterior face of the insula, the anterior surface of the insula, okay? And again, I just did remove anatomically the frontal parietal operculum and the temporal operculum, okay? So you see that the temporal operculum is given only by the superior gyrus of the insula. The middle gyrus of the, of the temporal lobe, the middle temporal gyrus and the inferior temporal gyrus don't cover the insula at all. And by the way, you see that the inferior temporal gyrus is very short here laterally. It's very long along the base. But in order to expose the inferior temporal sulcus, you have to do a very basal craniotomy, very basal, difficult. Generally, when you do a temporal craniotomy and you see a sulcus, it's always the superior temporal. It's difficult to expose the inferior temporal sulcus. You have really to drill the base of your exposure because this high is very short. This is not a high. This is very short. Okay? Now, coming back to the insula, anterior limiting, superior and inferior limiting sulci of the insula. The best paper ever about the insula was written by Ugur Ture, and he called this anterior peri-insular, superior peri-insular, and inferior peri-insular, different nomenclature. But it's more common to call limiting sulci of the insula. Now, when you look at the surface of the insula now, lateral surface, you see generically two types of gyri. You see a bunch of gyri here that are coming for this region, which is the apex. In this case, you have two apex here, okay? But it's coming from this region here. And then you have other gyri that are not related with the apex of the insula. And again, anatomy is definitions. So we call short gyri of the insula the gyri that comes from the apical lesion region. So this seems long, but this is not a long. This is a short gyrus because it comes from the apex. Usually, you just have two long gyri of the insula, and it's common to have a single one that then divides like a Y here. And so these are the long gyri, and these are the short gyri. And they are separated by what we call the central sulcus of the insula. Central sulcus of the insula. And guess what? Central sulcus of the insula is continuous with the central sulcus of the brain. This is precentral. This is central. Am I okay? Here you have longitudinal. Here you have vertical. So this is precentral. This is postcentral. So this is central sulcus. And it's continuous. And I know because the central sulcus of the insula is continuous with the central sulcus of the brain. Very, very organized. If you remove, this is Eduardo preparation, if you remove the cortex of the insula, you can see that the short gyri of the insula, they come from the same region, okay? Like Professor Yashajo likes to say is that what is underneath the cortex that shows the real connections. The surface, it's very variable, but subcortically things are more similar, more constant. And you see here a single long gyrus of the insula then bifurcates like a Y. But if you had it more superior, probably this bifurcation would be more inferior here. That's how it works. So this is the apex region. And this is where we would have the uncinate fascicle here and the IFOF coming here. Okay, now let's see here. I'm going to blow this region here to see this area where the inferior limiting sulcus and the anterior limiting sulcus and the inferior limiting sulcus is. And in the next slide, I'm going to have the superior temporal gyrus still in place. So the spatula is bringing the superior temporal gyrus inferiorly, okay? And this is the anterior wall of the insula. This is the apex of the insula here. This is the most anterior short insular gyrus, okay? So if this is the anterior short insular gyrus, it was covered by what here? The pars? Triangularis. On the pars operculares is this beautiful U here that is pretty much covering the insula. That's why it's called pars operculares. It's a real curtain. Now, the pars triangularis that was selectively removed here was covering mostly the anterior short insular gyrus, okay? And you can see that this is the opercular part. So what sulcus is this? Precentral. So this is subcentral gyrus. This is central sulcus. Anterior subcentral, posterior subcentral, a small subcentral gyrus, okay? So if this is postcentral gyrus, what gyrus is this here? The Heschel gyrus. You see, so things are always there. And you have a big space in between the anterior face of the insula, and what gyrus is this? Posterior orbital. Now, you see that you have the depth there of anterior limiting sulcus and inferior limiting sulcus here. You see that you have an interruption here? So if you have an interruption, it's because you have a gyrus going there, okay? So you have a gyrus here that it's coming from the apex of the insula and going towards the medial aspect of the posterior orbital gyrus up there. This is the transverse gyrus of the insula, anterior transverse gyrus of the insula. And this interruption here is just superior to this U-shaped space here. What is this U-shaped space upper part here? What is this? This is the limit of the insula. How do we call this? Limbing. So limbing insula is one thing. Apex is another thing. Apex is easy to expose. The limbing insula is more deep. People generally says that the limbing insula is this U here. No. The limbing insula is just the upper aspect of the U because it's related with the insula. This down here is already related with the temporal operculum, okay? But you always have this very well-defined U format space here. This is limbing insula. This is apex of the insula. Okay, so here I did remove the anterior part. And I'm seeing the head of the caudate. It's interesting that you have a space and a recess anterior to the head of the caudate. I forgot to tell you in the morning when I was talking about the temporal lobe that we have a recess anterior to the head of hippocampus also, in between the hippocampus and the inner aspect of the amygdala, bulging inside the ventricle. Just like you have this recess anterior to the head of hippocampus here, you have this recess anterior to the head of the caudate. That's why I can cut here carefully and expose the ventricle without damaging the head of the caudate because I have this recess here. Okay, you see? And in between, what do I have? The anterior limb fibers of the anterior capsule. This is the anterior wall, anterior face of the insula. This is the apex. Okay, so we're going to be seeing that if we take an axial plane here, superior to the level of the apex, I have ventricle. And inferior to the level of the apex, I have the region of ventral striatum that I talked about to you yesterday. So if I open very widely the sylvan fissure, open the anterior ascending branch and the horizontal branch, or in the right side, if I remove here this part of the operculum, pars triangularis and so forth, I'm going to be exposing this most superior aspect of the anterior limiting sulcus of the insula. You see the apex here. And you see how close I am I'm from the anterior horn? Getting inside just anterior to the head of the caudate in that recess that I talked about. Now, what happens if I get in here below the apex? I'm going to be getting where I don't want to go, to the ventral striatum, where I have lenticular striate arteries and everything, accumbens and everything there. We're going to be returning to this area tomorrow through a pterional view. So apex of the insula, if you go anterior limiting sulcus of the insula, superior to the apex, you're just next to the ventricular cavity. And you can use this as an approach, for example, if you have a cavernoma just lateral to the head of the caudate, okay, you can just go this way. And it's very frequent, very usual to be operated on GBMs here, for example, and then you come CSF, you said, whoops, what did I do? What is this CSF? It's because you're very close to the ventricle, as you can see here. And in the back, if you see the Heschel gyrus, underneath, under the post-central gyrus, you are very close to the ventricle. So here you're very close to the anterior horn, as I showed, and here you're very close to the ventricle as well. So, but here it's difficult to open the fissure because it slips, it's flat. If you want to deal here, you're going to have to remove the base of the supramarginal or the upper aspect of the superior temporal gyrus. No way of damaging this if you want to get through here. So here again, you have the Heschel gyrus going posterior to what we call the central core of the brain, right? The anterior half of the central core, anterior half of insular, related head of the caudate, posterior half with the thalamus, hence with the third ventricle, and Heschel gyrus coming always towards the atrium. If we see from above, I go through here, find a beautiful you. This is the paracentral lobule, right? Always central sulcus, precentral sulcus, always interrupted. You see the middle frontal gyrus connection here? I saw that it's superficial. You usually have this superficial here, pretty much. Now, the superior frontal gyrus is a very well-defined gyrus. And the superior frontal sulcus is very deep, very deep, very deep. Superior frontal gyrus very frequently harbors a secondary sulcus inside it that it's called medial frontal sulcus. Not important at all. This is superior frontal gyrus. Very, very common to have tumors here. Very common. Okay? What's the name of this medial part and posterior part of the superior frontal gyrus? What region is this? SMA, exactly. In SMA, you have lots of low-grade tumors. There is a French study on low-grade tumors that says that about 50% of low-grade tumors are here and in the insular regions. If you take low-grade tumors insular and SMA, you're dealing with 50% of low-grade tumors. So this is very frequent, also for high-grade tumors, as you know. And usually the connection between the superior frontal gyrus and the precentral gyrus is pretty much medial along the SMA area here. And tomorrow we're going to be seeing the sulco key points. And where the superior frontal sulcus reaches the inferior frontal sulcus, that is interrupted here, you have a key point that usually has the cisternal aspect. Usually has the cisternal aspect. But usually, generally, where you have where two important sulci meet, you have an enlargement of the subarachnoid space, and this can help you in surgery. So this is superior frontal gyrus, this is paracentral lobule, superior precentral and postcentral gyrus. So you can understand that very frequently you have a tumor along the precentral, and along that connection goes to the middle frontal. Very common to have this, and then reaches underneath the superior frontal sulcus that would go to the superior frontal gyrus. If you know this anatomy, you can understand where the tumor is going through, and of course you can plan better the resection of the tumor. Let's go more posterior. What is this here? Exactly, paracentral lobule. Beautiful you, just like the opercular part. So the central lobe always is an ellipse excavated by the central sulcus, okay? Now, if I come to the parieto occipital region, what sulcus is this? Intraparieto. So what gyrus is this? Exactly, supramarginal, because you see, intraparieto, inferior parieto lobule, supramarginal and angular. So this is the superior parietal lobule. It's a region, superior parietal lobule. But when you get here, you see always see a very deep sulcus here. And you see another beautiful you here. What is this here? Let's see. What is this? Exactly. This is the depth of the parieto-occipital sulcus. You have here calcaneal fissure, and its midpoint you have parieto-occipital sulcus. Parieto-occipital sulcus is so deep that you always have this depth here. And if you have this depth, it's because you have a new shaped convolution here. Okay? Nowadays, it's interesting because old anatomists, you'd call this internal perpendicular fissure. Because this is calcaneal fissure, and they used to call parieto-occipital sulcus internal perpendicular fissure. And they used to call this external perpendicular fissure. In simians, the external perpendicular fissure goes until here. You don't have this interruption here as you have in humans. But nowadays, we call this parieto-occipital incisure. Parieto-occipital incisure. And this parieto-occipital arch. But this was called by Broca parieto-occipital connection of Gratiolet. Parieto-occipital connection of Gratiolet, which now we called parieto-occipital arch. And this is parieto-occipital incisure, which is the depth of parieto-occipital sulcus. Of course, you can call this parieto-occipital sulcus. But when you reach this point, the intraparietal sulcus becomes intraoccipital sulcus, of course, from here. Because this is, from here to here, you have superior parietal lobule, which is continuous with what here? Precuneus. And this is the cuneus. And this is the lingual gyrus, which is continuous with inferior occipital and will be continuous with inferior temporal. Okay, but we'll get back here. Now, anatomy has lots of names. This, which I'm calling interoccipital sulcus, is also called transverse occipital sulcus, and is also called superior occipital sulcus. It has three different names. But what is important for us is that this is the superior occipital gyrus. Superior occipital gyrus is a region, but you always have a gyrus here that is vertical, it's longitudinal in relation to the interhemispheric fissure. And then you have the middle occipital and the inferior occipital that in this case is pretty well defined. You see here is not this well defined. The inferior occipital is always there because it's continual inferior temporal and it's continual with the lingual. But the middle one is more difficult to recognize many times. But here you can recognize a very well-defined middle occipital. So middle occipital and inferior occipital, they are parallel and more, while the superior occipital is vertical, is longitudinal in relation to the fissure. So again, this is superior occipital. This is inferior occipital sulcus. But the superior occipital sulcus is also called interoccipital, which is continuous with intraparietal, okay, and also called transverse occipital sulcus of occipital sulcus. But you always have this depth here separating, of course, the parietal lobe from the occipital lobe. When we go to the medial surface, we have this very well-defined inner circle here that was called by Broca the limbic gyrus. Okay, now we know that this is cingulate, this is isthmus, and this is parahippocampal. Okay, you have here the calcaneal fissure. Of course, this is parieto-occipital, this is cuneus, right? If this is cuneus, intracuneal secondary sulci, this is precuneus. Precuneus always harbor this multiple Y-shaped secondary sulci. Precuneus. What sulcus is this? Cingulate sulcus. The cingulate sulcus is very deep, and it always ends with this ascending branch here. And when you have the end of the cingulate sulcus, everything that it's anterior is the paracentral lobule. So paracentral lobule, posterior has this very deep cingulate sulcus. That's how radiologists recognize, because they see a very deep sulcus here. And then you have a paracentral sulcus, which is another branch of the cingulate sulcus. So between paracentral sulcus and terminal part, distal part of cingulate sulcus, you have paracentral lobule. So this is central sulcus here. Everything anterior to the paracentral lobule is the inner aspect of the superior frontal gyrus. SMA area is here, right? So this is superior frontal gyrus. And superior frontal gyrus is always continuous with the rectus gyrus. This is rectus gyrus. Rectus gyrus is separated from the cingulate by the superior rostral. Everything that is facing down is rostral. So this is superior rostral. Superior rostral. Inferior rostral is always inside the rectus gyrus, always inside. Now, if you have superior rostral, it ends here. You always have a connection between the cingulate and the rectus gyrus. Already mentioned, does anybody remember the name of this beautiful U here? Another beautiful U? Always there is the cingulate pole. This name was given by Asagil. Cingulate pole. And behind the cingulate pole, you have the para-olfactory area of Broca, the two para-olfactory gyri, and the para-terminal gyrus. We're not seeing them here. They are anterior to the anterior commissure, which is here. But at this point, I want to emphasize the beautiful U, which is the cingulate pole, and just posterior to the superior rostral. Now, let's come back here. You have the calcane fissure. This is cuneus. What gyrus is this? Lingual. And what gyrus is this here? Parahippocampal. You have here the uncosulcus. Uncosulcus. Definitions. What's the name of this piece of brain here? Isthmus. Okay. The real name is just isthmus. But we call isthmus of the cingulate gyrus. Isthmus put together two pieces of earth. So here, just putting together the cingulate and the parahippocampal. By definition, the isthmus ends here at the proximal end of the calcane fissure. So here begins the parahippocampal gyrus. So this is parahippocampal gyrus. So you can see the parahippocampal gyrus is a continuation of the isthmus and mainly of the lingual gyrus. PCA comes here, it's related with the uncosulcus, gets inside here the subiculum, and then goes along the calcane fissure, the proximal part of the calcane fissure, and then here divides parietoccipital artery and calcarine artery. And this division here is very much related with this point. So if you come here and you see the bifurcation of the arteries, you can know where the cuneus is. Okay, now this proximal part of calcane fissure is not primary visual area. The distal part is, okay? Not this one. And you see that the precuneus gives a contribution to the parahippocampal gyrus also. We're gonna be seeing this. This is the apex of the insula, the apex of the uncus. We're not seeing, but inside the apex of the uncus, what gyrus do we have there? Amygdala. Ambient gyrus, ambient gyrus. Amygdala is inside the anterior half, inside inner, and the head of hippocampus is inside the posterior half. But superficially here you have the ambient gyrus, okay? If you open here the uncosulcus, you're gonna see band of Giacomini, you're gonna see other small gyri here. Band of Giacomini is the continuation of the dentate gyri that it's hidden there, okay? But here you have the ambient gyrus. We're not seeing, but there's a sulcus superior to the apex of the uncus. The sulcus is called, we're not seeing very well, semi-annular. And what does it run along the semi-annular? Anterior choroidal artery, going towards the inferior choroidal point. Okay? So this region is very important for epilepsy surgery. You always come from lateral, but of course you're dealing with this region. What gyrus is this? Looks like an arrow. Fusiform. So what sulcus is this here? Collateral. Okay. Occipitotemporal is lateral to the fusiform. So if you see here, you see the cingulate pole. Beautiful U, you can see here. So this is superior rostral, inferior rostral inside the rectus gyrus. The medial surface of the brain is very constant anatomically because it's phylogenetically old. Multiple Y-shaped secondary sulci, these are called all together subparietal sulci. Subparietal sulci. And you see how the radiologists recognize the paracentral lobule because this is very deep. The ascending distal part of cingulate sulcus is very deep. And then you have the paracentral sulcus just anterior here. And this is all paracentral superior frontal gyrus, SMA area here. This black thing here is the flow void of the PCA. You see the PCA here? And here, parieto-occipital artery and calcarine artery here along the calcarine sulcus, calcarine fissure. So this anatomically very constant here. Again, let's see this region here. Beautiful U, cingulate pole. Continuation of the cingulate with the rectus gyrus. Harboring inside here, what sulcus? Superior rostral. Superior rostral, cingulate pole. Then anterior parofactory, posterior parofactory, and paraterminal gyrus. Septal region here. Continues with indusium grisium that is here. And then you would have the gyrus fasciolaris going around the splenium and continues with hippocampus. We're going to blow this region here to see how is this distal part of the parahippocampal gyrus. You see here the parahippocampal gyrus. Okay? It starts here. You see how deep is the calcarine fissure? How deep is the calcarine fissure? PCA comes here. This is the uncus sulcus. What is this flat surface here? Flat surface here, what is? What's the name? No, let's start here. What is this thing here? This is thalamus. What is this band here?
Fornix.
Fornix, of course, the fimbria. That's dentate gyri. What is between the dentate, you have this, the hippocampus sulcus here, and then you have this flat surface. It's the bed of the hippocampus and bed of the thalamus. What's the name of this? Subiculum, yes. Somebody was saying. Subiculum means bed. Okay, you see, it's the bed of hippocampus and bed of the thalamus. A flat surface here, subiculum. So PCA and subiculum, remember the transverse fissure of the brain? What do you have here? What cistern you have here? You have the ambient cistern here. Okay, you have the ambient cistern. So PCA comes, the uncus sulcus can get inside the subiculum, and then comes here related with the calcarine fissure, and here divides in parieto-occipital and calcarine and calcarine branch. Parieto-occipital and calcarine branch. But PCA can get inside the depth of the calcarine fissure. You see how deep the calcarine fissure is? So what gyrus is this here? Lingual. And you see how it continues with the parahippocampal? This is the splenium. You see that the splenium also gets inside the parahippocampal gyrus. And this is isthmus. The isthmus gets inside here. And you have the precuneus there coming here and giving a contribution. So I would say that the parahippocampal gyrus is just like a big tree. Okay, this is the tree, and then you have the branches. The main branches are the lingual and the isthmus. But you have a small other branch of the precuneus, and you have the splenium getting inside here as well. This is the apex of the uncus. Head of hippocampus would be inside here, amygdala would be here. Here, ambient gyrus. What sulcus is this here? I talked about. Semi-annular sulcus. You have anterior choroidal artery here. will get inside the inferior choroidal point. And this is semi-annular gyrus here. Ambient gyrus, semi-annular gyrus, semi-annular sulcus, anterior choroidal artery. PCA comes related with the uncus sulcus. Amygdala, anterior half, posterior half, head of hippocampus. Amygdala covering, you saw all this. We almost finishing here. This is the basal part, orbital surface of the frontal lobe. And you always have this H-shaped sulcus here, which is the orbital sulcus. So the orbital sulcus altogether has this H-shaped here. The most posterior part looks like a Napoleon hat, as I said, and is the posterior orbital gyrus. So if you remove this anatomically, you're going to be seeing the anterior surface of the insula. Of course, this is medial orbital. This is lateral orbital. This is anterior orbital. A small other, small secondary sulcus inside the anterior orbital. This is all anterior orbital gyrus. This is posterior orbital gyrus. Posterior orbital gyrus is anatomically more constant, okay? And of course, laterally, you would have the most lateral orbital gyrus continues with the orbital part of the inferior frontal gyrus. It's continuous around the corner. And here you see the superior temporal meeting the inferior temporal and becoming the temporal pole. This is uncus. What's the name of the sulcus that we didn't talk very much that separates the uncus from the rest of temporal pole? What sulcus is this? Rhinosulcus. Separates the uncus from the rest of temporal pole. H, superior orbital gyrus, posterior orbital gyrus, medial orbital gyrus, anterior orbital gyrus. What gyrus is this? Rectus gyrus, olfactory tract, medial stria, lateral stria, optic nerve, optic tract. We'll come back to this to end this lecture here. Uncus, apex of the uncus. What sulcus is this here? Rhino, exactly. The definition of rhinosulcus is that, because sometimes you don't recognize very well, but you have to know rhinosulcus is the sulcus that separates the uncus from the rest of temporal pole. Phylogenetically, the hippocampal sulcus is the first sulcus because hippocampal sulcus separates dentate from parahippocampal gyrus. So separates archicortex from paleocortex. This is paleocortex uncus. This is neocortex. So rhinosulcus separates paleocortex from neocortex. It's the second sulcus, phylogenetically. Okay? So this is the uncus, amygdala, head of hippocampus. Now, what is the anterior perforate substance limits, which are anteriorly the lateral stria, the medial and the lateral and the medial stria. Posteriorly, the optic tract. Medially, the interhemispheric fissure. And laterally, we're not seeing the limbing insula. This is the limits of the anterior perforate substance. Posterior perforate substance is everything that is behind, posterior to the optic tract. So this is all posterior perforate substance, including the interpeduncular fossa and its roof. So here you have anterior perforate arteries, and here you have posterior perforated arteries. Of course, this is the pituitary stalk. This would be the tubercinerium area, just anterior to the mammillary body. What is the up there, this posterior there? Anterior commissure. So this piece of brain that has this anterior wall, the anterior perforate substance that would be here, has as its posterior limit the anterior commissure, is the ventus striatum that is here. We already went through this. Tomorrow I'll come back to this through a pterional transylvan perspective. So just to finish then, what gyrus is this here? Fusiform. So what sulcus is this? What sulcus is this? Most of the time, the rhino is continuous with the collateral, not at this specimen, okay? So this is temporal pole. This is uncus, an ugly uncus here, but you can see an apex. So collateral sulcus separates the lingual from the inferior occipital, then separates the lingual from the fusiform, then separates the parahippocampal from the fusiform, and then separates the parahippocampal from the inferior temporal. Here you have a variation anatomy. But the fusiform, he is not well defined, but I would say that this is the region of the fusiform. Okay? If I divide here, what do I have inside here? Inferior horn. Inferior horn ends pretty much here, doesn't come up here. And what do I have here? Atrium. Atrium already sitting in the tentorium. And this part of the fusiform sitting in the petrous bone. And from here, already everything that it's anterior here, sitting in the real middle fossa floor. You have to have this architecture. Splenium, what are these things here? What part of the fornix? Crude of the fornix. I see you learned this. So if you see here, what sulcus is this? No, we are pretty... What shape is this? What part of the ventricle? Atrium, okay? So what gyrus is running here medially? And more laterally? Fusiform. The posterior part of the fusiform, that it's the floor of the atrium. So what sulcus is this? Collateral. And I forgot to tell you what name of sulcus is this one. Occipitotemporal. You see how they go towards the nearest ventricular cavity? So this is inferior temporal.